It's a great pleasure for me to have this opportunity of interacting with young minds. And I envy you. You are all living in a great country. A country which is known for its short history, but great successes. Singapore is a country with just about 5 decades of history. But in just 5 decades' time, this country, a city state, has today emerged as one of the strongest economies in the world, most resilient. We have seen the way the recent coronavirus pandemic has been tackled by the leadership of Singapore, the effective way it has been contained. All this shows that the leadership and the people of Singapore are very great. They have a vision, they are disciplined, and they are committed. I come from the country India, which has also tried to tackle this pandemic in the best possible manner. Unlike Singapore, India is a very big country with 1.3 billion population. Together with massive population is the challenge of the density of population. With that kind of density and what that kind of size of the population, the Indian government has also succeeded in containing the virus in a significant way. In a way, we have learned some of the lessons from Singapore also. For example, the experience of Singapore in contact tracing, strict lockdowns. We also have learned from many other countries in our neighborhood, for example, from South Korea, their contact tracing app has become an inspiration for India to develop its own application called the Arogya Setu. Arogya Setu is again an application which helps the people know about the location of the pandemic infected people. In just 2 weeks' time, this application has been downloaded by 500 million people. We have learned these things from countries like Singapore, countries like South Korea, and tried to tackle this massive healthcare challenge of the coronavirus. Not just Singapore and India, the whole world is facing this challenge today. Countries are struggling. Countries that are seen as very powerful, very strong, economically like leaders in the world. Even those countries are today facing the brunt of this pandemic challenge. This will pass off. Like all challenges that humanity faces from time to time, this also shall pass off. We must have the confidence that together we all will defeat this pandemic and the humanity will finally come out victorious. From the Indian experience, I can only tell you this much, that if we are today in a position to contain the spread of the virus, to tackle it more efficiently than many other countries in the world, it is because of three reasons. Number one is that we have had a leadership like the leadership in Singapore. We also have a leadership which is a visionary leadership, which did not hesitate to take certain timely and strong measures. The second reason is the way the country's bureaucratic setup has risen to this challenge. It is actually a big surprise to many of us in India. Those elders who are present in the audience would probably agree with me that when you talk about India's administration, India's healthcare establishment, or India's law and order establishment, the police, one generally looks down upon these institutions. People think that in third world countries or in the developing countries like India, all these systems are either inefficient or corrupt. But to the great surprise of all of us, it is that very system which used to be looked down upon, which used to be condemned, has stood up in a very inspiring way. I have seen doctors who have not gone to their houses for weeks on. Weeks together, they have stayed in the hospital serving the patients. Same is the experience with the nursing staff. Same is the experience with the police. So the entire system, the entire institutional establishment of the government has risen to the occasion. But third and most important experience of India has been the unity and discipline demonstrated by 1.3 billion Indians. Without that, probably we could not have contained this major challenge of the pandemic. India remained united. Indians remained disciplined. When the government, when the Prime Minister asked them to stay home, don't come out, they strictly followed. There were certain challenges in managing certain sections of the population, but largely the country remained indoors following the guidelines issued by the healthcare establishment and the government from time to time. This unity and discipline of the people has been of great help in managing and containing the virus by our government. Now, as I said, we will all overcome it. But while overcoming it, we are going to enter into a different world. I have a number of youngsters in front of me, students, who are going to witness a different world when they graduate. A few years from now, the post-pandemic world is going to be different from the one that we all have been living before the pandemic struck us. That is something that we all have to carefully understand. In this new world order that is going to emerge post the COVID challenge, we all have great opportunities waiting for us. If we seize those opportunities, if we are prepared to move in a new direction that the world is offering to us, we can build a new human-centric world order. Thus far, we were living in a profit-centric world order. We were living in a prosperity-centric world order. We were living in a conflict-centric world order. We were living in a war and violence-centric world order. But pandemic has taught us many lessons. If only we understand those lessons, if only we come forward to build a new world order, it will be for the benefit of the entire humanity. I will just talk about three or four lessons that coronavirus pandemic has taught us. And based on those lessons, how we can build a new world order post the pandemic. Firstly, the pandemic has taught us to respect the nature. You cannot play with nature. In Indian culture, we call nature as mother. Prakruti, nature is mother. A child should milk the mother, should take milk from her. He should not squeeze her life. We have to milk the nature. We have to respect nature. We have to learn to live in such a manner that would not only protect our environment, our climate, our nature, but also promotes it, enhances it. The challenge of climate change, the challenge of environmental problems that the world is facing today, should become an important agenda item based on the lessons that we have learned from this coronavirus. India has been championing the cause of climate change for the last several years, friends. We are working on alternate energy sources. We are working on ways of improving the climatic situation in the world, decreasing the pollution levels. Lots of youngsters are sitting here. Let me tell you that the number of deaths per thousand caused by corona pandemic are nothing in front of number of deaths that happen annually because of pollution. Do you know that? People die out of pollution-related problems annually. The rate of those deaths is much higher compared to the rate of deaths that is happening because of the pandemic. Every death is bad. Every death should be mourned. But as we come out of the pandemic, it's our duty to now work towards saving those lives which we are losing annually on a daily basis to challenges like, to problems like pollution. So climate, environment will become a big agenda for the world. It should become a big agenda for the world. The youngsters should come up with new ideas to protect or preserve our environment, our climate, our nature, and our Mother Earth. The second lesson that the pandemic has taught us. Of course, in this, I will probably exclude countries like Singapore. Countries like Singapore, very few in the world, have world-class healthcare systems. But not all countries are so lucky. Healthcare, especially the universal healthcare, is still not accessible to billions and billions of people in the world. In many countries in the world, only the rich can afford good healthcare. The poor, the ordinary citizens, do not have access to good healthcare. The pandemic has alerted all of us to that challenge as well. We have to quickly build best healthcare infrastructure all over the world, not just for the privileged few, but health should become a kind of a fundamental right of the last man on this planet. Towards that, we have to come up with a number of innovative ways. I'm not just talking about disease management. When there is a disease, you need a cure. But we can also come up with innovative ways of healthcare, health management in such a way that disease itself becomes a very rare thing for the people. So we have to now work on improving civic infrastructure in the countries. We have to teach people about best healthcare practices. What are they? What should we eat? What we should not eat? How to lead our lives? What should be the daily routine? Things like this have to be seriously considered, and people have to come up with new ideas. On its part, India has contributed yoga as a major healthcare management system to the world. Thanks to Prime Minister Modi's initiative, today yoga has become a universal practice. The whole world today practices yoga. In fact, a week from now, on the 21st of June, the entire world, close to 200 countries in the world, are going to celebrate International Yoga Day. Yoga is not about disease management. Yoga is about healthcare management. So we have to come up with many such things. In fact, the Southern Hemisphere, or you call it the Eastern Hemisphere, we all have rich healthcare practices in our countries. In India, we have systems like Ayurveda. These are healthcare systems that have excellent remedies or excellent lessons for people to follow. So we have to think at the entire healthcare establishment from a totally innovative and different way. We have to come up with different ideas. The third, which probably would be to the liking of most of the youngsters here, is technology. Post-COVID, technology is going to become a very, very big priority item for the world. Newer technologies. Technologies based on IT, information technology, like robotics, artificial intelligence. These are all going to play a very big role, because for you to take the benefits of new world order to the last man, you need technologies, new technologies. It's a huge opportunity for the youngsters. But technologies should not become a tyranny for mankind. We have produced technologies that have become a tyranny. We need technologies that help humans. We need technologies that do not make countries, people jobless. Rather, we create technologies that provide more employment, that provide more jobs, but at the same time, that make life easier for the people. So artificial intelligence, robotics, in these areas, huge opportunities are going to come up in the post-COVID world. And finally, the last thing that we all have to seriously ponder is, if today Singapore or India can claim to have contained the virus in a big way, one important reason is we have a disciplined, orderly social system in our countries. We have been able to build rule-based governance in our countries. We should now become an example for the rest of the world. When the pandemic struck, some countries became totally chaotic. Anarchist tendencies have come back to haunt some countries. Armies have to be deployed on the streets. Certain political leaders felt that it is a good opportunity to take more control, become more authoritarian. But we, India, Singapore, South Korea, we are the countries which have maintained our rule-based order. This is a very important lesson to the world. Rule-based order is to be preserved and protected. When challenges come, there is a temptation in the minds of the leaders to become more authoritarian, to become more dictatorial, to grab more powers into their hands. We must guard societies from such tendencies. my dear young friends, this is the kind of new world order or new priorities in the post-COVID world that you would all be confronting. It is generally said that the youth is the future of any nation. I consider it as a very charitable statement, because in my opinion, youth are not the future, but they are the present. It is you, the youngsters, who have to think what kind of world we have to build. For very long, we have left it on the political leaders of different countries. I have nothing against political leaders. I am myself in politics. But as youngsters, if you really want to understand how nations are built, you must study the histories of countries that are today seen as developed countries. In all those countries, in their histories, it is the young people of those countries who have taken the responsibility in their own hands, and they have changed the destinies of their respective nations. So please don't think that your turn will come later in future. It is now, it is here. As you pass out, you have to pass out with ideas of shaping a new world. Some of the lessons that I mentioned can be the guiding lessons for us, but many more that come out of your own ideation, of your own thinking, can and should guide all of you. My best wishes to all of you. JAS under Mr. Atul Tebunikar is an excellent institution. I mean, this one initiative itself shows that Mr. Atul cares not just for classroom teaching alone, but he wants the students to be exposed to so many things that are happening to the global reality on a regular basis, so that your mental horizon will open up. You will think big. I heartily congratulate Mr. Tebunikar for his initiative, and also thank him for giving me this opportunity. I will be at the mercy of our young friends for some time. Thank you and namaskar.